Today we sit down with Assemblymember James Ramos, a longtime friend of SEBA and law enforcement supporter, about the challenges and successes of this legislative cycle. Assemblymember Ramos, thank you so much for being here with us today.
Thank you for inviting me.
We're all navigating through, you know, that term new normal is used a lot, but we're all navigating through this pandemic, right? And it's been months and months now, but you were able to pass a bill, AB 2112, that deals specifically with some of the mental health aspects of that. Tell us why that was really important, especially now.
Those that know me from the county know that we've been focused on mental health issues for our first responders, for those that go through some traumatic experience as individuals and employees, that we need combat counselors. We need to make sure that we're meeting the demand of the issue that's facing many people in our communities. So I moved forward on AB 2112 that would create an Office of Suicide Prevention. And then I introduced that bill. And then COVID-19 hit and showed the real true need that we need something like this in the state, not just at the county levels, but at the state Office of Suicide Prevention, to show from the top down that it's something that's important. And I've made the statement over and over, there's no way that we can move our economy forward unless we're tackling the mental health issues of those in our community.
I think something that we appreciate here at SEBA, and of course why you have our overwhelming endorsement for, you know, this election, it's the fact that we can have the conversations and you challenge us and we educate you and we educate each other so that there can be a better way forward. And so we appreciate that from you, but we also appreciate those hard questions
that's right.
You ask us.
Right.
And I think people may lose how important that is to be able to disagree and challenge each other, but respectfully. It doesn't have to be so divisive in terms of being able to talk about a lot of these things. And you're able to balance that pretty well.
Well, I think it's one thing because we've seen things here in San Bernardino County as a county supervisor. We've seen how officers put their lives on the line to protect our community. We've also seen December 2nd and seen how coming together as a joint law enforcement community to bring closure to a terrorist attack here in San Bernardino County. We've seen a lot of that. We've also seen how officers are held accountable here in San Bernardino County. So I speak up on what I know. Others might say, well, that's not happening in other parts of the state, but yet all I know is the areas that we've been through and bringing up those voices. One of the things that we brought up on the debate last session on SB 230 and the other bills that were there getting resources out. So SB 230 was getting more resources to local law enforcement during that time. And it was during that time that on the floor I brought up, because there was a female deputy that was in the high desert that went to serve on a domestic violence call that ended up getting attacked, beaten, and her gun taken from her. And then the individual pulls the trigger and it jams. And that wasn't even enough for that individual. The individual then re-cocked and tried to shoot again.
Right.
The deputy got away. Other deputies responded. That's the true life that we see here in San Bernardino County. That's the true examples of what we bring to the table. I wish that all legislators would be able to see firsthand the very plight that our law enforcement officers are engaged in. Going out to a domestic violence call versus pulling somebody over, known gang members, there's a whole spectrum of law enforcement that's keeping us safe. But again, I know through what we've been through here in San Bernardino County that the ones that will step up to hold officers accountable is the agencies themselves.
Nobody hates when somebody tarnishes the badge more than those that have to wear it. And so that's something that we try to remind, you know, not just you, but everybody that we talk to in Sacramento and all of our community members, that we also want to move forward in doing whatever we can to make our profession better, you know, collaborate, but have the discussions. There's too much, well, you're pro-police, so we're not going to talk to you, or you're anti-police, so we're not going to work with you. How damaging is that to actually being able to get bills done that will work?
I think that's something that we're faced in our community now, especially 2020, just didn't bring COVID-19. It brought a lot of dissension and division within our community. And many times it's either just a hot or cold or a yes or no, right? And if you're a yes, then you're on this side. And if you're a no, you're on this side. There's no meeting in the middle. meeting in the middle to discuss on how better resources can be, how maybe a change in tactics that are being used, right, can be addressed, right? And, but if you stop short of going all the way, then you're seen as being on one side or the other. I think what needs to happen is a genuine discussion of those that want to come together for mutual respect and understanding of here's what's being faced in the community, and here's what's being faced on the side of public safety, but how can we come together to make it better?
Right.
Right now, there's so much division that discussion is not even being held.
You were able to get another landmark bill in, and this one is really important to you. I always feel like we're doing a alphabet soup, number soup, but this one was AB3099.
Yes.
So tell us about why that bill was incredibly important.
So that bill is pretty, really important for not only our community, but the nation, right, for the state of California, to start to lead the way to start to address the missing and murdered Native American women in the nation. And when we did research, we found that California was number 6 on the list.
Wow.
So we went to work. We had a hearing with our Select Committee on Native American Affairs, and we had a hearing. We shown that some of the areas was the difference in understanding Public Law 280 here in the state of California. Not so much just on the tribal government side, but in law enforcement side also.
And another thing I know that you were passionate about in the last legislative session was that we can't forget the victims.
That's right.
The victims of crime and the victims of, you know, these things that happen too. Because I feel like too often when we're taking those sides, even though we shouldn't, there's this... The conversation no longer lies around the victims and what they have to, you know, live through and go through.
We've gotten to a point to where what happens to the victims isn't even part of what's being discussed. We need to get back to honoring those areas and honoring resources to the families that have lost someone. Just right now in San Bernardino County, over 900 people have lost their lives to COVID-19. There's debate going on whether it's real, whether it's not. Well, should we open the county back up? But how much resources and how much attention are we giving to those families that lost somebody due to COVID-19? Victims in this whole atmosphere that's there. Victims of crime. Victims that continue to have their voices not being heard at the level they need to be heard. We need to make sure that we stand strong and be that voice for the victims, not only here in the Inland Empire, but across the state of California.
Well, we know that you are an advocate for this region. We know that you're an advocate for the residents of the 40th District, and you wholeheartedly have our support at SEBA. So
thank you.
Thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you so much.